We're jumping into a new series here, getting ready for Christmas. And so the title of our series is He Came To. He Came To. Everyone has questions and their opinions on why Jesus came to the earth, you know? And so we want to cut through and find out what the truth is, because Jesus himself in the scriptures says why I came. And so there's statements that literally say that, I came to, and then he tells us. And so we're going to examine those for the next handful of weeks. As we jump into it, I want to ask, are there any baseball people here? Any baseball people here? You got some baseball people here? I'm not a baseball guy, really. I don't really get into it. I don't want to, you know, say anything's wrong with it, but it's not my game. But if you're into baseball, you may know what I'm about to tell you, and that is, does anyone know who played in 1958 in the World Series? You had half of it right. You're going to say Yankees no matter what year I said. Yeah. Close. It was the Yankees and the Milwaukee Braves. Okay, so here, this is interesting. I heard this. I'm not a Yankee fan. Ever. I'm from Boston, right? Ever will I be a Yankee fan. But I'm also not a Red Sox fan because I'm not a baseball fan. But So I don't know anything about the baseball. I don't know anything about the Yankees, but I do know a guy who played on that team. His name is Yogi Berra. Anyone ever hear of Yogi Berra? Right? Wasn't the most prolific ball player in the world, but he was good, but he's more known for what he says than what he does, right? And so he's got all these different expressions and everything. But anyway, the Yankees were playing against the Milwaukee Braves. Yogi Berra was the catcher for the Yankees, and on the Milwaukee Braves side was one of the most prolific home run hitters ever, Hank Aaron. You don't ever hear of Hank? Everyone's heard of Hank Aaron, I'm sure, right? So Hank Aaron, the story goes that Hank Aaron comes up to bat, and you baseball people know this, what is a catcher supposed to do when someone comes up to bat? No, chomping them gums, right? Just messing with him, getting his head, right? Getting his head, and Yogi was really good at that. So Yogi's down there, right? And Hank Aaron comes up, and Yogi starts whispering to him, hey, you should swing with the label for the bat, pointing upward. Like, it's not a big deal. It doesn't matter which way you hold it, right? But if you're a baseball player, you have worked on a routine, and you've got up, you're up, and you're zoned, and you're ready, and like anything is going to mess you up, right? So that's all he did. You know, Hank, you should swing with the label of the bat facing up. Messes with him. So he gets up there. The pitcher throws a steamer right down the heart of the plate, and nothing. He steps out of the box. He steps back in. And the same thing again. Yogi says, Hank, you should bat with the label of the bat facing up. Next pitch comes in, and he just crushes this thing into the upper decks. Goes around the bases, goes around, tags home, takes a few more steps, stops, looks at Yogi and says, I didn't come to read. I came to hit home runs. And he walks out. It was an awesome story, right? Hank Aaron, the reason I'm telling you this, Hank had absolute clarity as to why he was there. He knew the purpose for which he came. He was there for one reason and one reason only. It was to hit home runs, and he knew it, and nothing was going to derail him. And that's exactly what Jesus is like. He knew exactly why he came. And so what he wants to do is he wants to make it clear to you why he came. And then for you also, you need to understand why you're here. And you're going to learn that by figuring out what Jesus came to do, okay? He had complete clarity of purpose. And I hope that you will too. Now, here's a couple of verses. I'm just going to, and you know, you can jot them down. Oh, you know what? Here's notebooks. Anyone like to take notes? Yeah, I love that. Awesome. You want one? Yeah, here. That's awesome. This is what I like to see. Anyone else? Yeah. Yeah, I only got two left. Elder statesman. Elder statesman. You better not steal it from a lady, right? And there's pens. Where her husband is, he'll come back in the room, he'll whoop you still. Don't forget that. Yeah. Okay, so you can jot these verses down. You don't have to read them, but here's some verses that you'll see in Scripture. Not all of them, but here's a couple that Jesus clarifies why he came. Matthew 4:43, he said he came to preach the good news widely. He came to preach good news. Acts 1:8 says that you're going to be my witnesses, right? So just like him, he's going to preach the word and the kingdom widely at different villages. Well, like that, we the same. Acts 1:8, you're going to be my witnesses to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. We're supposed to do the same as Jesus. John 10:10, I came that you might have life and have it abundantly. Matthew 20:28, I came not to be served, but to serve and give my life as a ransom for many. So we kind of couple that up with John 12:27, where it basically says, yeah, I came to die. I came to give my life as a ransom for others. Luke 19:10, I came to seek and save those who are lost. Mark 2:17, I came to call sinners to repentance. Matthew 5:17, I came to accomplish the purpose of the law. There was purpose behind the person that came into the manger. So this little baby comes down, but there was purpose behind him coming, and Jesus makes it quite clear in the scriptures why he came. Okay, so that's information right there. There's some verses, there's some information. Jesus is like, here's some information, this is why I came. Okay, that's good. But if the scriptures don't cause life change in you, then it's just a good story. Can someone say amen, right? Okay, so here that was information. Here's application. You see why Jesus came. This is why I came, but application is this. Me, what's that mean for me? Well, Romans 8:29, it says that God's plan for all of us is that we would become like his son. We just saw what he came to do, right? So you're supposed to be like that. John 20, 21. This is a verse. I'm gonna hammer this verse through the whole series. You got to know this one. As Father, as you have sent me, so I send them. See? So that's the application. Here's the information. This is why I came. And application is now what does it mean for you? We're supposed to do just as he did. So that's what we're going to dive into. Now tonight's scripture is a little bit thicker, a little bit deeper than the other weeks will be because there's a lot to the verse. And so I want to go through this one with you. The first one that I want to cover with you is something he stated in Luke 4, verses 18 and 19. And so if you have a Bible, please pick up a Bible and read it. Don't count on me. Don't depend on me. Pick it up and open it up to Luke. Luke chapter 4, put your eyes on God's word. Man, it's a treasure. It's the only thing that'll change you. It's the only thing that brings life. It's not going to come from me, right? It's not going to come from me. It's not going to come from the guy next to you. Look at the guy next to you. Say, it ain't going to come from me. No, it ain't going to come from me. It's going to come from God's word, right? So Luke 4, 18, this is what happens. I'll give you, while you're turning there, let me tell you what's going on. Jesus walks into a temple, right? So just pretend this is a temple back in his hometown of Nazareth, and he walks in. And you know, everyone, when Jesus walks in, what do you do? Right? There's the rabbi. Right? So he walks in and they hand him the Torah, this thing that Jared was just reading. Let me have that. And so the five books of Moses, the first five books, right? The Jewish guys, they're always studying that stuff, right? Sorry, I'll give that back to you so you can open up to Luke 4:18 through 19. And so he walks in, he grabs it, right? And of all the text that's in the Old Testament, he opens it up to the book of Isaiah where it says this. And he quotes this. And he says that the Spirit of God is upon me. And he's anointed me to preach the good news to the poor, to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, that the time of the Lord's favor has come. And then he puts it down, and they're doing exactly what you're doing right now, staring right at him. He's like, yeah, all that right there that you've been waiting for 800 years, I'm right here, right now. That's me. I'm the guy. I'm the one you've been waiting for, right? That freaks him out. Some people liked it. Some people didn't. Try to kill him, right? But that's what he said. This guy. The time of the Lord's favor, when God's going to bless his people, when he's going to meet his people, he's going to come down and hang out with them. The promise I made to you forever, I'm right here, right now. And that's what he said to them. Now, he wasn't just talking about preaching good news to the poor. Like, we need to get off the shallow end of the pool, you guys. Okay? He's not just talking about what he said, like shallow end. Because you know, people still stay poor that know Jesus. Yeah, right? Proof. Jailbirds still stay locked up. They meet him. They meet Jesus. They're still there. Some for life. They don't always get released, right? Blind people. Some get healed. Some, once you meet Jesus, they're still blind. Some of them, right? And the oppressed. I don't even know, give you another word. If you're under something and it's hammering you one day after another, week after week, month, year, and some people meet Jesus and they're still suffering, right? So we know from experience that it's not, Jesus is not talking shallow end of the pool here, saying that, you know what, just because you get to meet Jesus, boom, you're going to be able to see everything. Just because you get to meet Jesus, that the charges are dropped, everyone get out of jail. Get out of jail free card. It's not Monopoly. It's not Monopoly. See, we're talking about he's talking about a deeper gospel. A deeper gospel, and that's what we're going to look at. You know, the scriptures say we should move on from the sophomoric stuff and get into some deeper stuff, and that's, Lord willing, what we'll do. So let's talk about this first thing. It's preaching the good news to the poor. Does that mean no cash? That's a question. Could be, right? Could be. It could be that he's got no cash, right? But I think that poor has a deeper meaning. I don't think Jesus was even talking about that. Jesus was not a prosperity gospel preacher. Do me a favor, look at Revelation chapter 3. Go to Revelation. That's the scary book that nobody likes to... Yeah, right? Yeah. Woo-hoo. It's got like dragons and beasts and stuff. People that aren't even Christians like this book, right? It's a good book. Revelation 3:17. Jesus is talking to people that are going to church. Like, who's going to church here? Everyone should raise their hand. You're in it, right? Okay, so Jesus says this in red, right? So it's him talking. He says in verse 17 of chapter 3, he's talking to these people in the church. He says, you say, he's saying that they're saying this about themselves. I'm rich. I have everything I want. I don't need a thing. But so what are they saying? So is it a cash thing, right? They're saying I got tons of money. I got deep wallets, right? But listen what Jesus says. I have everything. And Jesus says, and you don't realize that you are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. Those aren't affectionate words, are they? If Jesus tells you that, something has to give. But the point of this is that it's not just about money. See, they had a bunch of money. And Jesus said, no, you have all the cash in the world, but you are poor, and you are wretched and poor and miserable and blind. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 10. Just jot that down. Here's Paul, right? And Paul says this. He says, we are poor. He's talking about him and his other apostles and believers that are going around sharing the good news, right? And they had nothing. If you read the Bible at all, you know Paul had nothing. He had no wealth at all. He says, we are poor. We own nothing, right? So we're talking about cash, right? Cash. We're poor and we own nothing, right? So he's cash poor. But what does he go on to say? He says, yet we have everything. We have everything. See, they understood, their brain and their heart had grasped the reality that the money and the stuff means nothing. And if you have all this, but you don't have Jesus, you have nothing. But if you have Jesus and you have none of this, you have everything. That's what they understood. So, and now look again also at 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. Now we're talking about Jesus. It says this. It says, though Christ was rich... Well, hold on a second. Anybody ever read the Bible? Anyone know anything about Jesus? What was his profession? He was a carpenter. He was by vocation. He was a carpenter and a rabbi, right? Okay. You're in the construction business. How many carpenters do you know are rich, right? They're blue-collar guys, right? Jesus was a blue-collar guy, right? He's not, I've never known this Jesus to be loaded, right? He's a blue-collar guy. And so it says, though Christ was rich, so we're gonna have to do a little digging, right? Don't be satisfied in the shallow end of the pool. You have to do some digging. Though Christ was rich, he wasn't, he became poor so that by his poverty, he could make you rich. Okay, so listen. How many people here, show of hands, say, he's raising his hand already. Amen. Just say Jesus anytime I ask you. When you got saved, cash-wise, on that day, jackpot, you were loaded. Show me. No. Cash. Cash-wise. When you bent the knee and said, I'm a Christian, all of a sudden you were just flat-out loaded money-wise. Come on. Just so you guys know, by default, they're going to raise their hand in sarcasm every time I ask something. They have been for 5 years. They're going to continue to do so. So just, that's just the way it is. Okay. So does this refer to money?
No.
It does not. 2 Corinthians 5:21 is another verse that's almost identical, but it gives us clarity as to what it meant. It says this, God made him, Jesus, who knew no sin. But what does that mean? He had a perfect relationship with his Father. Never a mistake, right? Imagine if you were a kid and you never did anything wrong, how your dad would just absolutely rejoice. All the dad said, amen, right? Okay, so he is rich in a sense. He's got a tremendous relationship with his Father. So God made him, Jesus, who was perfect with no, he made him who knew no sin to be sin, so we might be the righteousness of God. You see the exact thing here? In the verse I just told you a moment ago, though Christ was rich, right, with no sin, he became poor, he became sin, so that by his sin, he's on the cross, so you could be righteous. So he's rich, he comes poor, it's because you're poor, you become rich. And what's his richness? What's the richness that Jesus has? He has an amazing, perfect relationship with his Father. Father, I pray that they would be one as you and I are one. We are one, perfect unity in everything. They never fight or squabble or nothing. So when Jesus came to preach the good news to the poor, it meant more than just cash poor, do you see? And that's why we're in Christmas season now. So when you think about the Christmas story, which I'm not going to read till Christmas, is this, the angel of the Lord comes to announce this Jesus that's coming. And so what does he say? It was on Charlie Brown. You guys know this by heart. If you watch Peanuts, you know. But this is the New Living Translation of Peanuts, and it says that the angel of the Lord says, I bring you good news that will bring great joy to who? To all people. To all people. You know who the poor are? All people. Every single person. Listen, Donald Trump is poor. Bill Gates is poor, right? The richest oil sheik in the world is poor. Poor. Everyone. He came for all people. And listen, we all have to have an ends of the earth mentality, okay? We need to know that Jesus Christ came to this earth for every single person who ever lived, who is living, and who ever will. That's why Jesus Christ came to this earth. It's for every single person, whether you like them or not, the word of God that you profess to believe says that he is here as good news for who? All people, okay? Let's move on. So the first one is we want to preach the good news to the poor, which is who? All people. The second one is that captives would be released. Captives would be released, but we need a deeper gospel than that. Because not all people are released. Although we learned a couple weeks ago, remember Paul? When he was in jail and he got whipped and beaten and he thrown in the dungeon and he started singing praises to God. And what happened? The captives were released. The door flung open and the shackles fell off and he was free. So yeah, it does mean. Listen, just because I'm saying deeper, it doesn't mean jail doors can't open. Don't put anything past my God. Don't do it. So it could happen, but we need a deeper gospel than that. So let me go. This one's for you, Jerome. I'm going to kick it old school here. This is the King James Version. This is for you, Jerome. Okay, it's not setting the captives free. It's not captives released. It's to heal the brokenhearted. It's to heal the brokenhearted, okay? So let me get a definition up on the table for you. I think I got it up here. Do we have it up here? Did I put it in there? Yes, awesome. Okay, wait, erase that for a second. Don't look at it, don't look at it, don't look at it, don't look at it, don't look, don't look, don't look, don't look, don't look. heartbroken, right? Heartbroken. Like, I saw it and I started, and immediately something must come to your head of what heartbroken is. Y'all have our definition of heartbroken. You know, when your little high school sweetheart breaks up with you and you think you're never going to be loved again. Anyone ever been there? Yeah. Me and Troy, that's it. Love gurus, right? So you read that and you don't know, right? Because you got your little opinion. So let's get a definition up on the table so we know we shouldn't ever just blow by scripture. Like, oh, that's what that says. No big deal. Read it, stop, pause, pray, look it up, find out what in the world God's talking about. So here's what heartbroken really means. It's overcome with grief or despair. Like a tidal wave. You know, like a tidal wave, just overcome, like it's covering you completely with grief, despair. You know what despair is? Like hopelessness, like I can't escape this, I'm done. I'm overwhelmed with the fact that I can't be helped, I'm hopeless. To be filled with great sadness, that means there's no room left in you for anything happy. You're filled. Don't just take the words lightly. You're filled, right? That's why the Bible says to ask to be filled with the Holy Spirit, because if you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you can't act like the devil. So he says you're filled with great sadness because there's no room left for anything else. Do you see the condition of this person? Not so good. Now why? Not the only way, but especially, this is just in the definition, I'm making it up. Especially because someone you love has left you and the relationship ends. That's why you're overwhelmed with despair. You're completely immersed in a tidal wave of despair and sadness, and I feel like I can't get out. I'm hurting. My heart is broken. Romans 1, you should go there. Romans 1, you should go there. Because you're going to see that what it means to be heartbroken. I don't want to make anything up. It's not coming from this book. Don't worry about it. Romans 1 is a letter not just to the people in Rome, and it's not just to people here. It's for every person on earth. Every person on earth. So you can see where I'm going on this one too. Who's heartbroken? Everyone. Because it says in Romans chapter 1 that since the beginning he's made himself known to every single person. That they could just look out at creation and see the birds and the trees and the mountains and the ocean and the fish and the animals and the sunsets and the stars and you know that there's a God. Creation is screaming that there's a God. But it says there, in Romans chapter 1, 20 through 27, it says that they knew God. They saw it, but they denied him. They wouldn't even acknowledge him. And so they started to do some other things. They traded the truth for a lie. And they started worshiping creation, the things that they saw, instead of the one who made it. And so what happens here, if you look at Romans chapter 1, see if I can find it. Verse 24, they made a bad choice. They worship other things. They claim to be wise, experts, experts, experts. But instead, they were utter fools. And then verse 24, so God abandoned them. He abandoned them to do whatever shameful things their hearts desired. As a result, they did vile and degrading things to each other's bodies. They traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worshiped and served the things God created instead of the Creator himself, who is worthy of eternal praise. That is why God abandoned them to their shameful desires. Overcome with grief or despair, filled with great sadness, because someone you love has left you. And the relationship ends. Do you see it? Has he left? Say no. in a sense he has. He's everywhere, the Bible will teach. He's here right now. Every molecule that's here right now, he is here. But in a sense, he steps away, goes, oh, you want that? Is that what you want? Because we're over here, me and my people, we're over here doing our thing, and it's good. And if you want to go over there and do your thing, that's not so good, but you know what? I'm going to let you do it. I'm over here. And when you turn, I'm right here. But I'm over here, and you're over there doing your thing. Every single person feels that on earth. Do you understand? Every single person. There's a universal brokenness that's caused by our unbelief. And God abandons us to our sin. And he abandons us to the pain that comes with the sin. And the suffering that all of us in this room can testify to when we do something that is outside of God's will for our life. And the pain and the suffering that it causes. Every single one of us. Everyone. The scripture says in Ecclesiastes that God has placed eternity in the hearts of all men. Okay, we've heard that before, but what does it mean? What does that mean? It sounds good. Let me tell you what it means. It means that every single person on earth will search and search and search for that transcendent relationship that they long for, and they try to substitute it with stuff and fill squares into circles, and it causes pain and suffering. But God put that longing in the heart of every single person. That's why there's all these false religions, because they're trying to find some hope and happiness and joy. Because God puts something inside their heart that they cannot escape. It's on them all the time. It's hounding them all the time. All the time. We're always looking. But when we look elsewhere, he lets you. He abandons you to do that stuff. You want it? Go for it. Have it all you want. Have it till you're sick. Have it till you die. Have it all you want. When you're sick and tired of being sick and tired, come see me. I'm right here. I'm in the book. The sinful nature that all people are born with causes God to abandon us to our sin. It's unavoidable. Every single person has it. This universal search for this transcendent relationship that we can't find elsewhere, this longing that everyone is pursuing and tries to fix, but they can't. Well, this is why Jesus came. Jesus came to fix that loneliness and to restore the transcendent relationship with you and your Creator. That's why he came. The book of Colossians says it this way in Colossians 1, 19 through 22. I'm just going to kind of do the best I can. But it says that God in all of his fullness was pleased to dwell in Christ. And he's reconciled all things in heaven and earth back to himself through Christ. And this includes you, who were once far away from him, enemies of God because of your evil thoughts and actions. But because of Christ's death on the cross, he has brought you back into his presence, holy, blameless, and without fault. That's what the Bible says Jesus came to do. Sin separates, and Jesus restores. He's quite clear that there's no way to restore this relationship except through him. No one can come to the Father except through me, Jesus said. Now listen, Christians, it is our duty to ensure that this singular provision for the forgiveness of sin and the restoration of the transcendent relationship is found in Christ, and it is our duty to proclaim that to the ends of the earth. It is our duty. And listen, I know people in this room already are going, duty, duty, that's not a good motivator. Oh, yes, it is. You know why? Because the Bible says so. That's why. Listen, Luke 17:10. Jesus, in red, he says, listen, when you obey your master, likewise, when you obey me, you should say, quote, we are unworthy servants who simply have done our what? Our duty. That's what we're to do. If you have received this unmerited grace that saves you for eternity, listen, brothers and sisters, it is your duty to go proclaim the gospel to the ends of the earth. It is your duty. It is your duty. It is a joy. It is a privilege. It is an honor, but it is also what? Your duty. And that's not just because I like saying duty at church. It's your duty. Listen, again, as the Father has sent me, so I send you. It wasn't like a suggestion. You know, Jared, if you're not busy on Tuesdays, maybe you can go tell someone about me. I won't pick on you, you just walked in. You know, Pete, you know what I'm saying, right? It's your duty, it's your duty. As the Father has sent me, so I send who? Raise your hand if he sent you. Come on now, you're signing the contract right there. You're signing the contract. Okay, so he came to preach to the poor. He came to heal the brokenhearted. And brokenhearted is who? Everybody, right? The poor is everybody. The brokenhearted is everybody. There's going to be a theme through here. Maybe you can pick up on it. So here's the third one. Preach to the poor, heal the brokenhearted, the blind will see. The blind will see. Jesus said, I came that the blind will see. Now, in Matthew chapter 9, 27 through 30, you see this story with these two blind guys, Jesus walking by, and they're hollering out, Son of David, Son of David. Is he the Son of David? No. He's the son of who? God, and at very least, he's the son of who? Joseph, right? He's not the son of David. This is a claim to deity. These two blind dudes are screaming out, the eternal king is here. Is your grandmother okay? Okay. They're using my phone. I couldn't call you. Okay. You train wrecked me. Okay, so they're calling out to this to him, and they're calling him the son of David because the promise is that the everlasting king forever would be the one who would come in David's line. So when they're yelling out, son of David, have mercy on me. Is it because he's like some earthly king? Like how could the earthly king make someone see? No. They're calling out on the supernatural king of everlasting universe. Like that's who they're calling. And he says, have mercy on me. And Jesus is like, well, do you think I can make you see? Testing them, you know? And they're like, yeah. He goes, oh, then you're healed. So when he says, I came that the blind might see, could it be surface? Yeah, right. So then also in Matthew 15, small paragraph right here. There's verses 29 through 31, just a little paragraph. It's about that big in your Bible. And Jesus is there, and he sits down, and they all the people start bringing all the people. Like, paralyzed and lepers and blind and this and that, like lame and broken in every single way. And it says that including the blind, and he healed them all. So on the surface, could Jesus mean when he says that the blind will see, bless you, could he mean just that? Just the surface level. Okay. And should people who are blind call upon the elders of the church and ask them to pray so the elders can anoint them with oil and their prayer of faith, right? Right? Can bring healing, right? So we should pray for people. And we have prayed for people here. And we've seen God work through all that, right? And we should do that. Why? Because the Bible says to do it. So absolutely, we should do that. But will the blind see? Some might. Some might and some might not. I mean, how many people have prayed and prayed and prayed for something, right? I remember listening to and it didn't happen. I remember listening to anyone ever hear of Johnny Erickson Tada? Johnny Erickson Tada. She's probably 60. Little kid, she jumps off a dock into a shallow lake. She didn't realize it was that shallow and just spine, boom, paralyzed for life. She was like 14 or something. Just a kid, 17 years old, right? So she's paralyzed. She's paralyzed. One of the greatest evangelists the world's ever known. She gets up in her wheelchair. She can't move anything except her face. She paints with her face, moves her chair with her face, obviously talks with her face. Nothing else works. Loves the Lord like crazy, tells everyone about Jesus. And I watch her testimony, and she's talked in tears about, I mean, obviously she's got great faith. I mean, she's given her life to this Jesus that, and this lady, you know, if she didn't, I could kind of understand that one. You know what I mean? Like, I'm a believer in this. Like, I could understand if she went sideways, but she hasn't. She's got great faith. And in that faith, She begged. She's been begging Jesus for 50 years to heal her. And she never has been healed. So we know that it's that the blind aren't always going to see. But does that lessen the value of what Jesus said? It doesn't. Because there's a deeper gospel there yet. Again, you see? So, and I'm going to tell you right now, I think that the blind will see, especially, well, oh my goodness, back then in the Bible days and now, I guess the same thing's going on. I think that blindness is a spiritual blindness. It's a spiritual blindness, and you know, yeah, what's the, you know, we call the when someone cusses, we call it the F word, right? The F bomb. Don't drop the F bomb. Don't drop the F bomb. Let me tell you something. There's another one. It's the R bomb. Do you know what the R-bomb is? Religion. Everyone say, right? Religion. That's spiritual blindness. That's what he's talking about. And we know this because it's in the Bible. Listen. I was asking the guys here on Thursday night. I meet with a couple of guys here in the church, and we're talking about this was on the Tuesday night men's group. We were talking about what does it mean to be a good Christian? You hear it all the time. Oh, he's a good Christian. She's a tremendous Christian woman. She's a strong Christian woman. What does that mean? Does that mean she quit cussing and she doesn't drink as much anymore? Or she hides it? Well, I don't know. I don't know. We all have our ideas of what it is, you know, this behavior modification and keeping rules. Like, what does it mean to be a good Christian? Do you know her heart? Do you know that the Word of God has pierced his heart and he has changed his perspective? Do you know that? Or do you just see what he does? I don't know. But listen, rule keeping and behavior modification are not the apex of Christianity. They're not. They're a result of, but they're not the ultimate search. That's not the quest. And blind people quote verses, but they act like non-believers. You don't know, you heard it. They quote verses, but listen, it's worthless. In Matthew 23, Jesus 7 times says, "Woe to you, Pharisees!" In my translation, what sorrow awaits you, you that know all the rules, that have the book memorized and quote the scriptures. One of the woes, he says, you ain't getting in. You think you know it all? You ain't getting in. Woe to you, Pharisees. A.W. Tozer, one of the greatest American preachers who's ever lived, he said this, that to be a real Christian, there must be an actual inward experience of the text. Simply memorizing it means nothing if it does not change who you are. Religious people impose outrageous laws on people but will not bend a finger to help them. They're show-offs. In the Bible, it said they had prayer boxes that they'd put, these phylacteries that they wrapped with leather and with a box with a prayer on their hand and another one wrapped around their head with the prayer box on, with the little scriptures inside of it and the long robes and the big hats. We see that in some churches too, where they show off all their religious garb, but it's all what? Finish the word garb for me. Garbage. Garbage. It's garbage. Titles. Oh, he's the bishop. He's the pope. They love the praise of men. They look religious, like a shiny coffin on the outside, but inside of it is death. That's all it is death. It's death. Matthew 23 also, Jesus says 5 times to these people, he calls them, he says they're either you're blind, you're blind guides, or you're blind fools. Let me tell you something, Jesus never said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Now go memorize everything I told you. He said, go show everything, go do everything I showed you. That's what he said to do. He never told everyone to just go memorize his word, and that's what they were doing. And so that's why you see when they ask him, what's the rules, Jesus? What's the rule? He sums it up pretty easily. And there's really no restrictions on it. There's really no rule. He just says, love the Lord God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength, and then love the people just the same. That's what he wants you to do. Listen, when that kind of love permeates not just, he said mind, right? So you should love the Lord by using your mind. You should memorize verses like they did, right? You should, because the Word of God inside you keeps you from sinning, and it also helps you to minister to other people at the right moment in the right situation. It should roll off your tongue because you're well-studied. But it has to do more than that, right? Because he didn't stop with the mind. Jesus didn't say, love the Lord with all your mind. Have a nice day. He said, no, love the Lord with all your mind, heart, your emotions, your feelings, your soul. It should change your eternal destiny. The Word should change your eternal destiny. That's loving him with your soul and with all your strength. Work at it. Work at it. Work at it. Yeah. Work at it. So that's the great commandment. Listen, anyone with ears to hear should listen to what the Spirit's telling them right now. Right now. Not what I'm saying, what he's saying to you. Knowing and keeping rules will not cut it, never will, never will. As a matter of fact, Paul, who wrote half the New Testament, he said in Philippians 3, 5, and 6, he says this, I was a member of the Pharisees. The group of people that Jesus was going, woe to you, you ain't getting in. You're terrible at this. You're bad at the game. Paul was part of that group. He says, I was a member of the Pharisees who demanded the strictest obedience to the law. Okay, that's good. Well, how many parents demand their kids to be obedient to their rules? Okay, keep your hands up for a second. How many kids actually listen to you? Yeah. Again, Michael, of course. Yeah. Jesus, yeah. So, but he goes on to the verse, he says, and as to righteousness, in other words, my group said I had to keep the rules, but not everybody keeps the rules, but as for me, I kept it without fault. He was perfect at keeping the rules. But once God opened up his eyes, and I pray he's opened yours, and if he hasn't, let him open now. Once he opened up his eyes, that verse goes on to say that all that stuff, I consider it garbage. Some translations say dung, which is waste, duty, crap. It's nothing. It's worthless compared to the surpassing knowledge of knowing Christ as my Lord. And I'm not righteous on my own behavior anymore. I'm only righteous through faith in Christ. He threw all the rules out the window. All the rules out the window. Listen, there's a God who loves you. There's a God who loves you so much, he gives his only son to die in your place, to pay for your sin. He's a God who promises to provide for you. He's a God who promises never to leave you. He's a God who right now, he's begging you through my voice right now, if you have not said yes to him, to turn from your sin and embrace the free gift of eternal life through Christ. And if you will answer that call and turn from your sin and turn to Jesus, him and all the angels in heaven will throw a party on your behalf right now. Right now. That's what they'll do. Right? Listen. Doesn't matter what anyone's ever told you in church. I don't know everybody. I know you, but I don't know you. I don't know your heart. Only God knows. And some of you have been coming, but yet have never really bowed the knee. And I'm not talking about your knee either. I'm talking about your heart. You've never bowed your heart to the Lordship of Christ. And now is the time. Today is the day of salvation. You'll never have a better time than right now. Right now. Right now will never happen again. Never. Never. You say yes to Jesus. Listen, you have eternal life. That's amazing. Do you know that Jesus can't die? Like, he already died, right? And he rose again. He kicked death in the teeth, right? He can't die, right? And Ephesians 1:13 says that when you say yes and bow your knee to him, he gives you his spirit. And so if his spirit can't die, you can't die either. Hallelujah. That's an amazing truth. You cannot die. You cannot die. See, Jesus came to open up your eyes and to tell you the truth of all this stuff. And so now, listen, it's my joyful duty to do the same thing. And now it should be your joyful duty to proclaim this truth to the ends of the earth. That's what we're to do. That's what we're to do. Give me a drink. Here's the fourth thing. Preach the gospel to the poor, which was what? Everybody. The brokenhearted was what? Everybody. The blind will see. And as the oppressed will be set free. Well, guess who the oppressed are?
Everybody.
You guys are awesome. Let me take you back a little history lesson. Way, way back to Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1, God creates heaven and earth. And he sits back in his recliner and he looks at it and he says, "This is very good. This is very good." And then, Genesis chapter 2, everything's going well. Read Genesis chapter 2. It's the best chapter in the Bible because it's the only place where everything is just the way it's supposed to be. Genesis 3 through the end of Revelation, right? It's crazy. One chapter of good. One. It's kind of funny. You know what I mean? But Genesis chapter 2 is like perfect. Everything's good, right? And then Genesis chapter 3, wham. So there's the fall. The fall of man. The Bible tells us that because of the fall of man that all of creation is fractured. Alligators don't like us and they're ugly because of the fall. Yeah. Everything that's wrong is because of the fall. Disease, storms, strife, bitterness, rage, anger, addiction. The list is long. Just keep on coming, man. The list is long. It never ends, right? So here's Genesis chapter 3. The picture is Satan comes and he shows himself up in a serpent. A snake kind of looking thing. I wasn't there. So the snake shows up representing what? Evil. And he offers this fruit to this dumb woman who gives it to her stupid husband. And they both take the bait. Like, because everything was so wrong, you need to improve it, right? It was perfect, right? So they got to live on a cliff in Hawaii with no mortgage and perfect health and relationship with every facet of creation for free forever, and that wasn't good enough. So they had to take the fruit. And so the illustration that God uses is this serpent shows up, and now, as a result, in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, it says that man and the snake are going to have a problem now. Man and evil are going to have a problem, but here's the relationship you're going to have. Man, you will step on his head. You win, but in the process, he's going to bite your heel. He's going to bruise your heel. Like, it's not going to be easy. He's going to hurt you. He's going to hurt you. Now that's just a picture of our condition, our spiritual condition. We're not destroyed. How many people in this world that aren't Christians are still functioning, right? They're out there, they're walking and talking and holding down jobs and all this kind of stuff, right? So they're not destroyed without hope, but they're hurt. They're hurt. So imagine for a second, I love the picture because this whole idea of a bruised heel, like, I don't know about you guys, I've never been to the doctor for it, but that plantar fasciitis thing, whatever, so the bottom of your foot just, like, when you wake up in the morning and you think it would help because you've been resting all night, but you get down off the bed and the first, like, 2 minutes, it feels like you're walking on razor blades, right? Anyone else have that? I got it. It sucks, okay? It's awful. So imagine, if you will, because I get it. It hurts right now, but I've got my inner soles in my shoes to help me with it. See, I got this that helps me for that exact purpose. So I feel it all the time, and I'm feeling it even now as I walk. But So I know what it's like to have a bruised heel. But just imagine, if you will, if you didn't have this, if you had a bruised heel, like if I took your shoe off and I took a little hammer and I just went whack right to the bottom of your heel, and you're trying to walk around like this, right? That would jack you up completely. Like if you have a bum hand, you can still do stuff. But if you got a bum foot, it's always hurting. You can't do anything, right? You can still function. Like I could still go to work and I could still go to the kitchen and make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. I could still function, but it would hurt. It would absolutely hurt. It's just you're a little bit off, right? You're a little bit off. You're off. You can be off balance, off center. You know, you've got pain. And sometimes if you've got a pain in your foot, what do? You overcompensate a little bit so that you take the pain off. But what does that do? It just jacks up your hips and gets your back all hurting, and you got to go to the chiropractor because you got a pain in your foot. You can't go away. So it's a picture of sin. You're functioning, but you're hurt. Do you understand? You're hurt. And so sin does that. It just ruins everything. We're still alive. We're functioning, but we think wrong. And we say wrong, and we act wrong, and we plan wrong, and our perspective is wrong, and our morality is wrong. Our priorities are wrong, and our solutions to the problem is wrong. Wrong, 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 wrong. Well, we're still existing, we're still functioning, but what are we doing? We're malfunctioning. That's the condition of the human race. We're malfunctioning. We're malfunctioning. And so sin does that. We have this passive inheritance of sin that Romans chapter 5 talks about, that since Adam and Eve did this, it's been passed down generation to generation to all of us. And so that's jacked us up. But on top of that, our own willful rebellion right now that you live in keeps us there. That's the problem. It keeps us there. But, go back to the King James, right? It didn't say that he came that the oppressed would be set free. No, the King James says something totally different, and I love it. It says, Jesus came to set at liberty them that are bruised. That should rile you up. There's something wrong here, man. When I read that, I was crazy excited. Okay. Satan, you will hold down his head, but he will heal. He will bruise your heel. What is he talking about? Every person, right? Every person. But Jesus said he came to set at liberty those that have been bruised. Every single person on earth, that's why Jesus came. Jesus came to do that. We've been oppressed by evil and sin, and it's been controlling who we are. You know what liberty means? It's another word. You don't just blow by it. Liberty means, this is awesome, the state of being free from oppressive restrictions imposed by authority on one's way of life. At the beginning, Satan did this, and he has been given authority, and his sin and that he led us to has been oppressing us. The human race has been under the restrictive authority of Satan himself. That's the whole world. But Jesus came to set you free from that. That's why he came. He came. The enemy and sin have controlled us. They've dictated your destiny. They've decided your direction. They've poisoned all of your passions. But Jesus came and he lived a perfect and sinless life, and he willfully went to the cross to pay for the penalty of your sin, and he fully absorbed the wrath of God on your behalf. And if you agree to this truth and you receive this gift, then sin and death and evil and Satan no longer have authority over you, and you can tell them to go to hell where they belong. That's it. So let's just wrap this thing up here, and we'll call it a night, right? That helps my job so much. Thanks, guys. So Jesus said he came to set you free from the effects of the fall. Okay? But listen, the deeper effects of the fall. It's not just that every cancer will be healed. Listen, Christians die of cancer. It's not that every blind person will call on the name of Jesus and see, because sometimes it doesn't happen. But everyone on earth can be set free from the control that sin has on their choices and their destiny. That's why Jesus came. And it's for every single person. It's a deeper, deeper gospel. He came to restore an eternal Eden for you and I. You've been bruised and hurt, but Jesus said, I will heal and I will set you free. Listen, that's why my Father has sent me. That's why Jesus was sent to you. I came for this. And so my plea with all of you tonight is if you haven't received that gift, that he came to the manger as a baby to grow up and accomplish what you just heard for you. And so he wants you to reach out and grab that gift and take it as your own. Take him up on it, and then I'm going to send you out. Just like the Father sent me, I too will send you. This is the time of the Lord's favor. Right now. Right now. Today is the day of salvation for the poor, for the brokenhearted, for the blind, and for the bruised. That means everyone. And I'm going to end with this thought. I want to remind you all that Jesus Christ came for every single person on earth. When the scriptures say that he created men in our own image to be like us, and he came and to save for good news for all people. And his desire in Romans 8:29 is that all people become like his son. And 2 Timothy, it says, is my Father's desire that all are saved and come to an understanding of who I am. Our singular job, our singular duty is to go tell every person on the face of the earth that every sin they have ever committed has already been paid for. And we don't need to go and punish them for the sin that's already been paid for. Our job is to go tell them the good news that they can be loved and forgiven forever in Christ. That's the job of the church universal. That's our duty. That's our duty. And I'm asking if you will join me in that. I'm asking you to start in praying that God would give you and us a bigger vision for what we're supposed to do. He said we're to be his witnesses to the ends of the earth. Listen, if you're going to be a witness to the ends of the earth, it's not a part-time gig. It's a wake up thinking about it, spend all day dwelling about it, can't go to sleep because it's tormenting you. I got to go tell someone about Jesus. I have to do it. It's the reason I live. That's why he came, to set the captives free, which is there's 7 billion captives in this world. Plenty to do. We will never run out of you. Your job security is amazing. You will never run out of stuff to do for Jesus. And I'm asking you to join me on that quest and begin to pray about how we can reach the ends of the earth with the good news. He came on Christmas to bring good news to all people. All people. Listen, God is definitely about the numbers. A king's glory is a growing population. He wants 7 billion people with hands high and voices stretched to their limit saying, "The Lord is God." That's what he wants. That's what he wants. So we don't pull any more punches. This is the real deal. This is what the church is all about. And I want to stir up your passion for this. I want you to be tormented tonight that you cannot go to sleep because you have to go tell people about Jesus. Those are the kind of people I want to hang out with. Light my fire, people. Light my fire. Get hot and right next to me and light my fire. And let's go share the good news of the gospel of Jesus with the world. Please. I don't even know what I'm doing. I have no idea what I'm doing. Oh, I guess we're going to take communion, huh? All right, let's take communion. Awesome. Good. Perfect segue. I need some guys to come up. Give me two guys. Give me two guys. Two awesome guys that want to grab this and want to pass it out. Here, these two guys are coming up. Brothers. Awesome. 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 All right, so we're going to take a moment. Hold on a second. 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 Yeah, slide over a little bit there, big boy. Can't just start hammering down communion, man. Can't start hammering down communion. Now think about this, man. It's a big deal. See, we take communion every week. Sometimes it's not a big deal anymore, right? It's a huge deal. It's a huge deal. It's a big, there's no deal bigger. It's a big deal. So you heard a message tonight, and I've been praying. I came in here early this week, and I prayed over every single seat that he would fill the seat, and that he would work on the heart that's occupying that seat. That's what my prayer was. And so now's the time, because I'm going to shut up, and you're going to let the Holy Spirit of God speak to you, okay? And so this is what he does. He takes the person who has studied his word and passed it on to the people, and then he takes that message and he gets all up in it, and he gets all up in your heart, and he starts talking to you and changing you, and that's what he's going to do now. So I'm going to ask these guys, they're going to pass out the communion, but I want you to think, I want you to do what the scripture says, consider this Jesus. Consider this Jesus. This Christmas comes every year. It's the same story. It gets repetitive to those of us that have heard it 1,000 times. But listen, it's a huge deal. And he did not come to just be, you know, Ricky Bobby's little 6-pound, eight-ounce baby in a movie. It's cute, but it's not the real deal. The real deal is that he came to set the captives free. He came to preach good news to the world, and he set you out on that mission. And so that's what this communion's all about. This is about signing on to the army of God to fight for the souls of human beings. That's what I want you to think about before you put the communion to your lips. It's a big deal to be a member of his family. He said, if you love me, you keep my commandments. And my command is, Father, as you have sent me, so I send them. He didn't ask. It's a command. And so you think about that. If you can't say yes to that command, don't take the communion. Don't take it. Consider this Jesus. Not just who he is, but what he said. And then we'll get back together here in a moment. We'll take communion together as a family. Go ahead, guys.